Central Europe. Good afternoon. My name is Michael Bamberg, and I am the presenter of the first SQIP pre-conference workshop. And I'm a professor at Clark University, teaching in psychology. Currently, I'm the president of SQIP for this current running year. And Zach Wipf and I, and you can see Zach, are majorly involved in the organization of the conference. So we have two pre-conference workshops, one organized here by myself and Zach, and the next one tomorrow, same time, by Heidi Levitt. And Heidi Levitt is the incoming editor of Qualitative Psychology. So again, Zach will help tomorrow as well. And Zach and I, we will hopefully take you through the conference on Thursday, Friday, and Saturday at local times from 8 to 8, 8 in the morning to 8 in the evening. And we will have an extra page there where you can get more information on, in case you still have questions, how that is going to happen. With regard to recording, we have the recording in progress. So I think if you join us, it will automatically tell you. So I would like that not to make you just show your name, but rather be there in person, show your face, because I think that will ultimately help make this workshop a little bit more interactive, because if we can see each other, then we are also able to connect better and to use the chat function to get your voice heard. And I'm going to take you through the overview in a second. And then from there, we can move on with the kinds of specifics that I would like to highlight in this workshop today. Is there anything else that I needed to say at the very beginning? I don't think so. So what I wanted to start with is a little bit of a... Further into it, Steve Winwood is telling us or singing us. I do like this song and I would love to play more of it, but here I used to be. Okay, so that will be one of the themes, because the other theme is I'm not the same boy I used to be, and we will work through that as our two data sets later on. So here's the title: positioning, positioning theory, and then the focus on positioning analysis. And I will try, I have at least plan to try to make it really for beginners rather than for advanced people who already know everything about narrative analysis and also positioning theory. So I will work through it as best as I can to explain a couple of terms, terminologies. First, and the first one obviously is positioning. From there, I will move briefly into what has been done by others way before me on positioning theory, so theoretical approaches to positioning. And then I will turn my main emphasis, my main focus on the analysis of positions, positioning. And there in particular, I will focus on the construction of characters of the characters that are in interaction, like me right now with you, but we don't want to analyze those parts, at least not too much. But then in particular in stories where there are characters, that's where we look at how they are placed in relationship to one another, but in order to serve a function. And from there, we move into the navigation of identities as a particular way of analyzing the movement that speakers follow through with when they construct characters, and then in particular in stories and storytelling. And from there, and I hope to get this done in 30, 35 minutes, and then we have a little bit of a question answer period, we'll move in to the first example, and there I would like to spend considerable time. It's a politician, an American white male politician, and he argues that he is the same boy he used to be when he grew up. And I'm sure we will have a little time left to turn to Addison Chen. He is an Asian celebrity coming out of basically Hong Kong, and he argues that he is not the same boy he used to be. So this is a nice contrast, and I'm using both of these characters in an interview that they asked for with a male and a female interviewer, respectively, in order to demonstrate, to show. So that already, I should warn you, does not mean that I particularly in a particular way embrace whatever it is that they claim or their positions that they take. Neither do I identify with the interviewers and their ways of sense making, but rather I'm really trying to use this because these are, in my opinion, very good examples to demonstrate what I wanted to demonstrate in the next 2 hours, and then work with you through in as much detail as we can in these 2 hours. So let me start with the term position. Yeah, before we go to positioning theory and then to positioning analysis. So positioning is a metaphor, it's a spatial metaphor. And what I'm trying to do is I try to complement it with the notion of navigation. And the most simple way of thinking about this is when ships are in distress and they signal save our souls, they hopefully still have enough time to give their coordinates, their spatial coordinates, where they are. Yeah, and so what this is based on, and this is where a lot of positioning theory comes from and originally is at home, is to map out the spatial aspects of where, here in this case, ships are locating themselves. Yeah, and we know how this is done, that the coordinates around the globe are all fixating particular locations so that we know where we are in Remich, in Luxembourg right now, where that is, in contrast to, let's say, Beijing in China or Worcester in Massachusetts. That's where my home university is located. So there are these spatial coordinates that are part of an agreed upon system. So it looks at, if you look at the world, as if there's an objective way of marking spaces and locations, but these are all only locatable because of agreed upon arrangements that we had. And then it looks like the map is objective. I actually have in my office a map from New Zealand that is, from the perspective of my students, upside down. And they always ask me, and I say, well, when you come from outer space, that's maybe exactly, you see New Zealand first, and it's on top of the world rather than Greenland or Alaska. All right, so that just serves as a way of making positioning a little bit more understanding. Now, when we take it over into the branch of the social sciences, we take it over into how institutions or brands or sometimes products, but then in psychology in particular, people, persons, how they position a sense of who they are. And I try to call this, they take themselves in, they talk themselves into their coordinates, or they bring off their whereabouts spatially, but in doing so, in relating themselves to others, and we go through this also their history, and also in terms of who they are, in terms of an agent or a recipient, they bring off a number of agreed upon background assumptions. Yeah, sometimes we call these master narratives or dominant discourses. So they do that in order to make themselves understandable, to communicate with others. And in doing so, they create something that we can call identity, sense of self, or who am I? So this is where we are heading with this notion of positioning. As I said, it's a spatial metaphor, but in the realm of what we are trying to investigate, it is basic, assumed to be basic, to human action and human interaction. And it is built already on something that may sound a little bit more complex, that is the bidirectionality, because we assume that we are the product of world, standing on the shoulders of others. At the same time, we are also agentively, actively involved in creating, making a world, changing world. So we do this by constructing characters as positioned. And this is not just about ourselves, how we create others as characters, or how we are created by others as characters, but this is also in talk about the neighbors, two neighbors who had a fight or are getting along very well with each other. That's what we do there as well. We create these characters in a relationship to one another. The other basic assumption here is that we do this in talk. Typically, we don't just do that in talk. We also do this with the way we dress, the way we move our hands, or we did our hair this morning or whatever. But what we focus on today and what I have focused on in my previous work is through talk, through language, as one of the basic means within which we do this type of positioning. So in the process of making up characters and positioning them in talk and interaction, speakers then construe a sense of who they are. Yeah, relating my neighbors with regard to one another, with regard to my communicative partners, I'm showing my way of, now I'm using the visual metaphor, seeing them in a relationship. So two aspects seem to me making positioning particularly attractive or interesting, in particular for social theorizing and then social analysis. The one is that positioning views entities, people, but also institutions or brands as moving entities, or at least as movable entities. Typically also we create them in some way as an animate entity, having some life, so to speak. And this is in contrast to visual metaphors, and I have listed a few here at the bottom of this slide. Yeah, point of view, viewpoint theory, and also perspectivation. They are similar metaphors trying to do something similar as we do with positioning, but they are focusing on the perspective, on the visual aspect, and I think not quite capturing what positioning actually captures. The second aspect of what makes positioning viable is this bidirectionality. That on the one hand, we or characters are positioned, at the same time, speakers in particular position characters. So there's an agentive active component and there is an undergoing passive component. I call this the two directions following. So directions of fit. One is from world to person and the other one is from person to world. So these are two aspects, I think, that make positioning standing out vis-a-vis other competing concepts. And I come to that in a second. So now turning to positioning theory. Yeah. So what I just tried to describe was more a common sense notion of positioning as an activity and why that may be a concept that is viable to be theorized and then produced for as an analytic concept for empirical analysis. So positioning theory as a theoretical framework is supposed to bridge the kind of subjectivity or agency on the one side with what is commonly falling under the headers of structure or institutional constraints. Yeah, agency versus structure. That is a typical way of polarizing and positioning different types of concepts in sociology. Yeah, and the effort here is to explain, make sense of human action to better understand. And there, that's where positioning is located between a kind of deterministic worldview and a kind of voluntaristic worldview of where and how human action comes to existence. Yeah, and again, human action here is viewed as grounded in interaction, not only as individual acts and activities, but rather grounded in relational practices. So recently, this concept has been extended into the interaction between institutions, and here in particular, through the work of Luc van Langenhove, the interaction between nations or nation states. And I think this becomes particularly interesting right now, how the Russian Republic is presenting the kinds of actions in a particular light, and most of us view the actions, those actions, in a very different light. This whole framework, we argue, and I'm totally behind this, was standing on the shoulders of Wendy Holway, who wrote a seminal article in 1984, and then also of another seminal article by Bronwyn Davis and Rom Harry. And both of them, I think, were quite relevant in my own way of making sense of positions and positioning and positioning analysis. All right, so following up already on one part of positioning theory that leads us into the positioning analysis, which is our next bigger, larger part of this workshop, is when we bridge or map positioning into narrative practice theory, into narrative theory. And so this is where we divide the following three kind of, I want to call them, levels. So there is something happening right now, right here. I told a little bit of a story here when I just referred to how Bronwyn Davis and Rom Hari in particular were influential in my own thinking, which is a part of a storyline or a small story, we call it. But there's something in the interaction here and now where we create characters, where we make characters relevant, like the Bronwyn Davis and Rom Hari, for the here and now of this workshop. And that is one of the basic levels where stories are brought into being. So from there, then there is a second level, namely that is the world of the story, of what is being talked about, the characters within the story. So the first level is the characters in the interaction, and that's, I only see five or six of you right now, and myself, because I'm the speaker right now, but hopefully this will change in a little while. So the second level is when we talk about something that happened, typically in the there and then, in the past, but it can be fictional, it can be in the future. So this is where these characters that are brought into existence, that are created, so to speak, they gain their own characterhood in relation to one another. And I typically quote Hansel and Gretel, a fairy tale, because it's pretty dangerous for children in a way, maybe, but it has nicely these characters aligned. You know, Hansel as the dumb boy, Gretel as the first feminist, you could argue, and then there's the weak father and the stereotypically mean mother, who's a stepmother, of course, not the real mother. And then there are witches, and, so we create witches also. So we bring them in the story in a particular relationship so that actions and events can emerge over time and grow into a storyline, into a well-rounded story, typically, hopefully, with a happy ending where Hansel and Gretel come home and the father's wife died and he found a new one. I can't remember the exact story, but something like this. Good. Now, why are stories called into existence? Because for level one, we speakers who bring stories into the realm of the talk are trying to convey a particular view of what is relevant with regard to their relationship. So this is where particular kinds of discourses or backgrounds are brought into it, called into the story in order to make sense. So this is kind of the parallel of what we had when ships are forcing SOS. They try to get their frame, the locative framework into the here and now, so that others can see where they are and in that particular case can come to their rescue. So that's not necessarily the case when we tell stories. It could be that we ask for consolation or anything like that. But stories serve different functions, but that is exactly what we are then trying to analyze. How are these dominant discourses, how are particular backgrounds made relevant, and what does that tell us about the sense of the speaker in terms of how they want to come across? So very briefly, just to allude to a couple of competing frameworks. What we have, this is much more coming from linguistics, and where it started with the analysis of pronouns, and pronouns are a gold mine when it comes to also positioning, of course. So stance and stance taking by Jack Dubois and Engelbretson about 15 years ago. Claims making, these are sociologists, Spector and Kitsuse, and this framework also still very much alive. Then there was a framework that came out of Europe by Graumann and Kallmeier in 22. So that's 20 years ago, under the header of perspectivation. And there you all already see the visual metaphor that was guiding their work. And then, of course, the work by Irving Goffman, and also in conversation analysis in particular by Tanya Strivers on alignment and affiliation, and Goffman in particular on face work and face saving. So all these four are trying to capture the same as positioning is, and that is of how people in interaction are describing relational process, and in doing so, bring off, we could call their coordinates, their belongings, their place, their position in the world. There's one other one, and I want to focus on that for a second more, and that comes out of the sociology, in particular in Europe, for the last 15, 20 years now, under the header of subjectivation or subjectification. So what the sociologists are doing here is shifting their traditional emphasis on the analysis of institutions to giving more space to institutions and also people within institutions as active partners, active agents in how activities and actions, and in particular change, can be analyzed. So that's what I think makes these the approaches under the header of subjectivation different from stance, claims making, and perspectivation, even from, I think, alignment and affiliation, because it takes this bi-directionality of being positioned and at the same time positioning self and others as an agentive, but also as a process within which we are undergoers, within which we seem to be not in control or in charge. So again, subjectivation and positioning both share, again, as the previous ones, two analyze the relationships of people in the world and how they navigate the two processes from world to person and person to world, and as such bringing of their coordinates, their sense of self, their identity. Now, turning to positioning analysis. Yeah, that's the main part, and that's what we want to do with two data sets this afternoon here in Europe. I know in Asia, you are already in your jammies, and in the United States, you're just shaking off your sleep. So this is where we are headed with two data sets. Yeah, it's about the analysis of how characters are constructed, in particular then in stories and narratives, for the purpose of constructing a sense of self. Characters in relationship to one another as relational, and at the same time as being positioned and positioning themselves, as navigating, and here I'm turning to the following three dimensions. Yeah, these dimensions are ways of coordinating. One is, we already had come across this, coordinating and navigating this spectrum of agency and passivity. The second one is the spectrum of sameness and differences. I'll go through this in a little bit more detail. And the last one is the spectrum of constancy and change. Briefly, agency first. With agency and passivity, with these two directions of it, we are trying to give a sense of who is in control and who is not in control. What and where are these actions located in terms of some kind of potentially power dynamic also. So this is where we can create characters, ourselves included, as agents, as heroic, as somebody who is impacting and changing world, typically doctors, teachers, sometimes politicians, or as stoic, indifferent, unemotional, cool, having no real say or interest in changing or being affected. So staying outside of this dynamic seemingly, but that of course is also a position. And then in contrast to constructing a sense of a person or an organization as being victimized, as suffering, as undergoing certain conditions that are not in under the control of these bodies, so to speak. So this is where agency and passivity come into the analysis of these navigation processes. And what I have here is trying to show that agency, the two perspectives, where one forms the background and the other one forms the foreground in order to make something, and now I'm using again these visual metaphor, visible. Similarly, but different, the navigation of sameness and difference. How is this company or my university different from others? But how is it also similar or even the same? And in this realm, in this dimension, categories are brought to existence or made relevant, if you want, like gender, age, belonging, national, regional belonging, friendship belonging, but also race and ethnicity. In social psychology, we typically talk about those, or they typically talk about those, as in-group and out-group relationships. But I think that's where these kinds of categories are coming to existence in the navigation of, is a person the same or is a person different? Is the institution the same as others, and or how differs it? So with regard to the, I'm using the same display, that these categories are, I would argue, not necessarily outside, but they are constructions, and they are constructions typically in communicative relationships, where certain aspects are foregrounded so that others become backgrounded, or the other way around. Certain aspects are backgrounded so that other aspects become foregrounded and become, visually speaking, visual. So the last one now is the one that is particularly relevant, I think, for storytelling. And that is where constancy and change are being navigated. And this is exactly where people can argue, I'm the same person as I used to be when I was small, little, a teenager, when I was 30, etc. Or, you know, you can focus on the change. I am different from when, da 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 da. But this is the temporal dimension or the the temporal dimension in contrast to the synchrony dimension of the previous one, sameness and difference between people, between characters. And within this dimension, we typically in talk, in interaction, then we bring out, we bring off change, development, progress. Yeah, we use the metaphor of turning points, in particular in life stories. But we can also focus on stagnation or even decline and decay. Development and progress is something into a positive dimension, while the other one into a negative dimension. And I just want to briefly also argue that in all three of these territories, there are values involved. Yeah, none of that is free of values or moral perspectives. They are woven continuously in these three dimensions, and we see a little bit of how this is done in a little while. All right, so this is where we will turn slowly, but not quite yet, to the data where the argument is, I am the same, I'm not the same, I used to be. But before that, let me turn to the levels of positioning analysis. And I will contrast that with a slide that I had earlier, I think it was slide 8, where I talked about these levels as part of positioning theory. So when it comes to analysis, we start with the textual level. Who are the characters in the story? The Hansels, the Gretels, the Provosts, my kids. And so these are potentially all characters that are being constructed, created for the purpose of level 2, the here and now. But in the analysis, we go from level 1, we sort out the characters within the story first, before we try to argue, oh, this is the way these characters are positioned with regard to one another, in order to then make assumptions about this is what the speaker, the narrator, is trying to accomplish in the relationship between their audience and themselves. So, the third one then is where we can move on and take level 1 and level 2 together and say, what kind of master background assumptions are at work here? And what other kind of background assumptions could have been at work? This is where we can get into the realm of master narratives and counter narratives. Not today, that's for another date, but that's exactly where we can move from here. So this is slide 8 again from the positioning theory that I tried to explicate a little bit. And that's where level 1 is the one of the here and now. Yeah, where we try to start with why are people together opening their mouth, talking with one another, and how do they move into a story world, and what do they do in the story world that is derived from the goals, the functions of the particular communication. Yet the story characters are made relevant for the interaction in a particular situation. Yeah, so in the analysis, we turn it slightly around. We start, and I think this comes from traditional textual analysis, literary theory, literary history, where we start with how are the characters produced in the story, and then we look at what did the author try to tell us with these kinds of characters. Good. So just to add one thing here, because what I will focus on are apologies. And apologizing, I think, is a particularly interesting field for this type of analysis, for positioning analysis. But we have positioning and positioning analysis then going on in a bunch of realms. And I just listed a couple here. Let me just briefly talk about the job interview. Because in the job interview, there obviously is a lot of positioning going on. You typically refer to your previous employments or your education. So you construct a continuity or discontinuity in the temporal line that led you into this particular job interview situation. At the same time, you present a sense of self that is related to how active, how agentive do you want to come across. So you don't want to come across as taking over the company department, but at the same time, you also don't want to just construe yourself as a follower who is doing anything that the organization is asking you to do. And then the last one here, number two, actually, in the way I presented them, is how do you position yourself vis-a-vis your competing the other candidates who are also applying for the job? In a subtle but constructive way, how do you point out the differences and the sameness between others and how you stand out in a particular way so that you will be the ultimate choice? So this takes place in a number of other realms, and I listed a couple here so you have an idea of that. This is not just apologizing by politicians or celebrities, but that's where I'm going to show it shows up quite nicely. And let me just go. So what do we have thus far? We have identity branding as a way of navigating these dilemmatic spaces. I will be looking at politicians and celebrities and interviewees in particular as how they navigate their sense of who they are, how they want to come across. I also sometimes call it their brand. Brand is nothing that is necessarily negative. And what they're doing here is self-branding, trying to come across as authentic, and they have to, because if they are not coming across as believable, they lose the little trust that they once had. And we are focusing in the upcoming examples on how they navigate this agency, passivity, sameness and difference between self or characters and other characters, and the continuity, discontinuity, the constancy and change. So we are turning to two sets of apologies, one by John Edwards, the politician, and the other one by Edison Chen. And we'll try to check into when people apologize, they seem to employ narratives, and we'll be asking, why is that necessary? And it seems to be at certain points, not enough that we say, I'm a good person, I always was a good person. That's just not enough. We have to instantiate this, exemplify this, and that's the answer to the why question here. And then certain narratives seem to work and others maybe less so. So this is where we are. Before we turn to the data set one, I just wanted to open up the space a little for any kinds of questions that may have arisen. And I don't know whether I will be able to answer them, but maybe at this point, we can, before we move into working with some data, collect a couple of comments, questions, maybe for 10 minutes. I think that's about the time that I wanted to give myself. Yeah, we are doing fine. I was looking at my cell phone. All right, is there anything? And Zach will have a closer look at whose hands come up, because I cannot necessarily always see whose image is moving to the front here.
Oh, yes, it looks like Cynthia has a question.
I do. Good morning, everyone, from here in Washington, D.C. in the U.S. Thank you very much, Michael. I just wanted a point of clarification. So when you were presenting the theoretical territories, I immediately thought that you were suggesting that the three were mutually exclusive, or the analyst focuses on, you know, either agency or sameness versus difference or constancy versus change. But when you presented the methodology, I got the sense that as the analyst, we are considering the range sometimes. So for example, do you need an example? So the question or point of clarification is, in a particular analysis, could it make sense to focus on agency and sameness versus difference? Like, I'm doing a psychobiography on Michelle Obama, and I think that I'm focusing on 1 and 2 in terms of territory.
Yeah, right. Thank you, Cynthia. And thank you for being here. I can't see you, but it's great to hear your voice. There you are. Oh, cool. Okay. Right. I mean, what I will show in the data that I have here for today is, you know, how they are actually intersecting. Often we just have speakers, narrators focus on one. Where change is more relevant, but then in the data that I will play with, the change in agency and also the change in being some same and some different person with regard to others. And so typically one is more dominant and the other ones may fulfill aspects of pushing the dominant one that is under construction. But then at certain points, it's just one and no other of these dimensions that are being made relevant. And that happens more than having them nicely all sitting next to one another. And that's good that you made me answer that question, because that is sometimes the case when when my students have some data and say, well, you know, I don't find any of X or Y, but only one. That is more typical than atypical. Does that make sense?
Yes. And even though an individual is born into a culture, right, or maybe multiple cultures, we're really looking at their actions, so they might not be navigating that per se. Because from that perspective, sameness and difference might always be at play in the background. I don't know, I'll put a pin in that.
Well, you know, I mean, sameness and difference is the prototype for life stories, right? I mean, this is where, the assumption of life stories and also therapeutic interviews is that there is change is necessary. We became who we are due to a number of, and now what is it? And I think this is also where the therapeutic ethos is kind of so deeply in the kind of Eurocentric ways of sense making, that everything is happening in childhood. Yeah? And then in family, you know, and from there, the kind of route to where we are is relatively clear. And I think a lot of life stories exactly, and I'm looking forward to Michelle Obama's life story here, how much she puts into her early childhood and then derives the storyline from there. But anyway, yes, I mean, this is open to, I think, ultimately empirical analysis. And that's, I think, exactly where this type of analysis lends itself to see different parts, different components, and not just continuity or discontinuity, but rather also, you know, where and how people create themselves, make themselves, play themselves into an agentive position, and at other points in their lives, they are dominated by other aspects and other people, where the power relationships shifted. And at the same time, the relationship with regard to how did I fit in? Well, yeah, under the term terminology of belonging. Now, I think we put this in terms of fitting in and standing out. Yeah, being part of and also not being part of. Yeah, but it's always, that's one of my, I think, contributions. It's never, although sometimes speakers focus very much on one, but it is never one or the other totally. It's one against the background of the other. That's where, let's say, change stands out or constancy stands out and is made relevant with the rest of how protagonists and antagonists are played out with regard to one another.
Thank you. That was beautiful. Thanks so much.
You're so nice today.
I'm just being authentic, telling you the truth.
Thank you. Thank you. All right. If there isn't anything else, then let me continue. Okay, let's get back to it. Which one is it now? All right. No, come on. Good. Here we go. So let me continue now with the first data set. I mentioned John Edwards. He was at the time of when the scandal broke. And that was August, I think August 7th, actually, the scandal broke. He was a senator in North Carolina. And what happened is that he was caught having an affair. And when the news broke, every TV station wanted to have an interview with him. And he volunteered and asked Bob Woodruff from ABC Nightline out to his place in North Carolina. And we see excerpts from that interview. I should just mention, for those who don't know John Edwards, because nobody knows him anymore anyway, he was a very brilliant politician up to that point. And he was the idol of a lot of our Clark students in 2006 and 2007. And when his fall came, there were a number of students in my class at that time that were crying. You know, he embolized the green orientation of democratic politics. So that was a real bummer. The way this all happened was kind of very dramatic because he cheated on his wife while his wife was in hospital and had been diagnosed with cancer and then was in remission. And he addresses that briefly at the very beginning. But so this is the situation, and he basically argues, I am the same boy I used to be. So let's listen to it first, and I hope that the sound is...
How could you have done this?
Can I explain to you what happened? First of all...
Is the sound okay? Is it good enough?
Yes, it is. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Then we can play...
How could you have done this?
Can I explain to you what happened? First of all, it happened during a period after she was in remission from cancer. There's no excuse in any possible way for what happened. This is what happened. I grew up as a small town boy in North Carolina, you know, came from nothing, worked very hard, dreamed that I'd be able to do something hopeful and helpful to other people with my life. I became a lawyer. Through a lot of work and success, I got some acclaim as a lawyer. People were telling me, oh, he's such a great person, such a great lawyer, such a talent. You're going to go, no telling what you'll do. And this was when I was 30, 31 years old. Then I went from being a young senator to being considered for vice president, running for president, being a vice presidential candidate, and becoming a figure. All of which fed a self-focus, an egotism, a narcissism that leads you to believe that you can do whatever you want. You're invincible. And there will be no consequences.
So you're
and nothing could be further from the truth.
So you're some.
And the important thing is, could I ever get to the place, to that place, and allow myself to let that happen? And I believe the reason it happened is because I had gone through this long process where I became, at least on the outside, something different than that young boy who grew up in a small town in North Carolina. And because that young boy would never have done this, never thought about doing it, to his family or to his wife. I am no different than the person they knew. I am at my core exactly the same person.
Right, okay, so we see here how he tries to argue that he is the same person. And now we will try to figure out how is he actually doing that and how is it coming across? How is he bringing off an authentic kind of believable identity? So, let me see how I can.
How?
So what I want to do first is briefly read through it. Yeah, and then we'll watch it again. In particular, for those of you who are not native speakers of English, I think this comes as a long story. So the interviewer, Bob Woodruff, asks him, how could you have done this? And we'll check out what actually the implication already of this. This is a question, what is implied here? The answer to this is, can I explain to you what happened? And then he goes in three clauses into that his wife was diagnosed with cancer, but she was in remission. And then he argues also that that is no excuse for what happened. So we also hear that there is an excuse coming up, or that this falls into the genre of excuses. So then he continues, this is what happened, falling into nation. I grew up as a small town boy in North Carolina, you know, came from nothing, worked very hard, and dreamed that I'd be able to do something hopeful and helpful to other people in my life. I became a lawyer through a lot of work and success, and I got some acclaim as a lawyer. People were telling me, oh, he is such a good, great person, such a great lawyer, such a talent. You're going to go no telling what you'll do. And this is, I was 30, 31 years old. Then I went from being a Senate, young senator, to being considered for vice president, running for president, being a vice president candidate, and becoming a national public figure, all of which fed a self-focus and egotism and narcissism that leads you to believe that you can do whatever you want. You're invincible. And no, there'll be no consequences. And so Bob Woodruff seems to interrupt and say, nothing, he continues, could be further from the truth. And the important thing is how I could ever get to the place, to that place, and allow myself to let that happen. And I believe the reason it happened is because I'd gone through this long process where I became, at least at the outside, someone different. Different than that young boy who grew up in a small town in North Carolina. Because that young boy would never have done this, never thought about doing it to his family or to his wife. And I'm no different from the person they knew. I'm at the core exactly the same person. And I added, as the young boy who grew up. So Let me go through a couple of images first, and then we'll watch it again. And so then you'll see how this kind of grows together into having potential for the analysis of the three dilemmatic spaces. So with line two, can I explain to you what happened? Remember, that's the answer to how could you ever have done this? Yeah, the facial expression here is one that we can interpret as some surprise. Yeah, the face facially is facing the interviewer, and he is not avoiding eye gaze. And avoiding eye gaze is the unmarked case. It's the typical case if you've done something bad and you be caught, you know, and somebody says, how could you have done this? Like my mother, only a few times, said something like this. And then, you know, typically you avoid eye gaze. You don't look into the face and say, can I? Yeah. So here there is something that is noteworthy. Yeah, his eyes are wide open. The gaze is toward the interviewer. And we kind of need to put this into what is happening here into the larger picture of a self-presentation, of bringing off a particular way of making sense. So with line 16 and line 17, his gaze is very different from the one in line two. He's leaning back, his head, his body is leaning back, and he's pulling back from the interlocutor. Yeah. So his eyebrows are kind of squirting and they are narrowing. The facial expression to me signals a kind of a distancing, also a kind of disalignment. And now we've got to figure out, is it a disalignment, a distancing from the interlocutor, the interviewer, or is it a distancing, a disalignment from the object of references? What is he talking about? So we have to relate that. And with line 16 and 17 in a minute, when he says, people were telling me he's such a great person. Yeah. What is he trying to accomplish here? Again, with this type of bodily, facially expression. And then in line 36, there is this smile. And line 36 and 37, I think, nothing could be further from the truth. And this is, and I will play that in a second, where a body language expert argues he is trying to mask his emotion. But I think there's something really different going on. And again, I think a good positioning analysis might be able actually to uncover that and show that there is more going on than traditional or pop psychologists are trying to impose on what they assume must be going on. If an adulterer comes out and confesses and he is smiling, there's something vicious or weird going on. But I think there's something really interesting going on at this point, at least. Yeah. Leaning in, head moves forward, and there is an agreement. And again, with the interlocutor or with what is being referred to, and maybe they are both in a particular kind of sync. And this is where Tonya Ryman, and I have a little clip here, but I don't want to show it if you don't have the time. She presents herself. She published a book on body language, the power of body language. And she was called in, of course, by Bill O'Reilly for his Inside Edition. And she argues, I can't see this on the left-hand side. I can tell that he's being honest when he was talking about, I didn't think that I was ever going to be caught, because there is not much changing in his facial expression. There's no movement. And actually, he didn't ever do that. But then she says, the expression that really surprised me was the smile. He's coming out to discuss he's an adulterer, and he starts out by laughing. So my impression is that he is trying to mask the true emotions that he has, guilt, remorse, shame. So I think this is a typical pop psychologist, and sometimes my students are leaning also in this direction. Yeah, but he isn't laughing. That's number one. There is something that we just identified as a smile. Laughing is in a different category. But masking his true emotions, that possibly may be the case, but there's guilt, remorse, and shame, and that should be, this is the expectation, be the interpretive backdrop against which we make sense of why he is saying and what he is saying. Okay, so moving on from here to line 50 and to line 54, we see him in line 54, moving his head back again, avoiding, where are we? The forehead in line 50. Yeah, the eyes are wide open and he's distancing himself. The head is not fully moved back as we saw in previous slides, but there is a way of distancing himself. There's not a leaning in. The eyebrows are clearly signaling again that there is a way of removing himself either from the interlocutor and or from the content of what he's referring to. And then in line 54 at the very end, where he's claiming that he's exactly the same boy he used to be, I think that's where he is avoiding gaze, but he is aligning, and he expresses, his facial expression seems to be comfortable with what he's saying, but also with the way he is presenting a sense of who is to the interlocutor. So, and that's also where the issue of sameness over time is being referenced, is surfacing. And I think that's something that is particularly relevant. Okay, so moving on from here to trying to get back to the three territories, the three arenas, these spaces where agency is navigated in contrast to passivity. Is he presenting himself as agentive and in control, or as more a receptor, an undergoer of the direction of fit from world, from others, in particular his electorate and the folks who put all his their money or their votes into him, then how is he coming across in terms of difference and sameness with regard to others, and how is he manipulating constancy versus change? And I think we already realized that the issue of change and constancy is prevalent, and that the others that relates to Cynthia's question earlier are more in a relationship or more a function of how he navigates constancy and change. So let's listen to it one more time, and then I think we can turn to a more fine and micro analysis of how he says what he says, and how this is coming across.
How could you have done this?
Can I explain to you what happened? First of all, it happened during a period after she was in remission from cancer. There's no excuse in any possible way for what happened. This is what happened. I grew up as a small town boy in North Carolina, you know, came from nothing, worked very hard, dreamed that I'd be able to do something hopeful and helpful to other people with my life. I became a lawyer. Through a lot of work and success, I got some acclaim as a lawyer. People were telling me, oh, he's such a great person, such a great lawyer, such a talent. You're going to go, no telling what you'll do. And this was when I was 30, 31.
Oops, excuse me.
To other people with my life. I became a lawyer. Through a lot of work and success, I got some acclaim as a lawyer. People were telling me, oh, he's such a great person, such a great lawyer, such a talent. You're going to go, no telling what you'll do. And this was when I was 30, 31 years old. Then I went from being a young senator to being considered for vice president, running for president, being a vice presidential candidate, and becoming a national public figure. All of which fed a self-focus, an egotism, a narcissism that leads you to believe that you can do whatever you want. You're invincible, and there will be no consequences.
So you're
and
you're,
nothing could be further from the truth.
So you're some.
And the important thing is, could I ever get to the place to that place and allowed myself to let that happen. And I believe the reason it happened is because I had gone through this long process where I became, at least on the outside, something different than that young boy who grew up in a small town in North Carolina. And because that young boy would never have done this, never thought about doing it to his family or to his wife. I am no different than the person they knew. I am at my core exactly the same person.
Right. Okay. So this is what we have at this point.
How could you?
With line one, let's move ahead. How could you have done this? Falling intonation. So this is not really a question that requires an answer. It requires a response. But there's something else going on, and I want us to work with that for a second. And then the response that comes right thereafter, can I explain to you what happened? Rising intonation. All right, so is there anything that anyone would like to have here at this point in terms of what's happening? I think Andrea has her hand up. Hi, Andrea.
Hello, Professor. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Good. So first I would know, he had this interview at his house. He had the interviewer come to his house, which kind of shows a power dynamic where the person who's being interviewed has more power in the circumstance. But as far as line one, the interviewer says, how could you have done this? So he's asking him to take agency or claim to responsibility. And then in line two, where the response is, can I explain something? Can I explain what happened? So instead of playing off of what the interviewer said and saying, let me take responsibility for this, he's saying, let me tell you how this happened to me and I'm the victim. Taking agency away from himself.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Andrea. Can we hear more? Because I think there is this issue of agency. Yeah, who is in control and how is this managed? How is this navigated? Yeah, the agency. And I think we have something that is going on here already at the very beginning of this segment. Well, let me elaborate. Say again.
Oksana has her
hand. Okay, Oksana, I can see. Yeah, go ahead.
I don't know if it is okay for English, but for instance, in my native language, it is impolite to answer with a question to a question. I mean that if a person does so, then probably there is something special about it. So I would probably agree that as if he tears, you know, this interviewee, excuse me, this is the ambulance, as if he tears away the agency, so that he is the author, he would start and he would, provide the order how the things should go this way.
Thank you. Exactly. I mean, that's the first thing that comes to mind. I mean, there's a question on the floor, and the question is answered with a question. And typically, when this comes up in my interaction with students, when I ask a question and the question is answered with another question, it looks like that there's an avoidance of the answer, right? I mean, it's not a direct answer. It's not a direct response. And sometimes we think it's to gain time and to think about an answer. But I think there's much more something exactly along the lines of what you suggested of a power differential. And I think that's what Andrea also was after. Yeah, how could you have done this with the following intonation? There's an underlying accusation, right? You shouldn't have. That's obviously something that the person who is answering this question or this request to take up the term with this implication has to navigate somehow. Yeah. And it is done in a way here by moving the answer to an explanation. Yeah, explanations are typically given by scientists or people in the social sciences also who seek explanations instead of interpretations. And here we have a little bit of a quarrel between qualitative and quantitative or experimental approaches. Yeah, so he is moving the discourse into the realm of an explanation. And explanations typically have a certain sequence rather than let me tell you the story, or let me simply tell you, you know, I've done something very stupid and I regret it and I never will do it again. That could have been an answer too. But then the other thing, I think this is what Andrea mentioned, something that he argues has happened. Yeah, but there was in line one, there was a doing that was referenced. What did you do? And then whenever I say, well, this is what happened, I move the agency a notch down, right? I mean, lightnings happens or weather happens. Things happen that they fall down, but if they are pushed over, then there's an action that causes what happened. So he's focusing on the aspect that results in the happening or in something where he already removes a bit of his own agency out of it. Right? And then line 3, 4, and 5 are a quick aside, a reference to his wife's cancer and being in remission, and then also arguing that that is no excuse, but he wanted to get that on the record. Yeah, so that this is being said, it's being noted by him, and he is the one who is in control there. So, but now with line 7, this is what happened, line 6, 7. I grew up as a small town boy in North Carolina. Yeah, I mean, the question is, how could you have done this? This is what happened. And now I grew up as a small town boy in North Carolina. And you know, in a courtroom, the lawyer would have said, Your Honor, narrative. Yeah, this is irrelevant. You know, where you grew up and whether you were small when you grew up and whether it was North Carolina or Worcester, Massachusetts, it doesn't matter to what happened. Or, right, so there is something that we can call breaking into a narrative. And now we want to go and analyze this narrative the way it has been construed. Okay, can we work with this a little bit? Yeah, so this is what happened as the announcement, as the opening to a narrative, to, if we want to call it, this is a narrative, a mini life story, a mini life narrative. But what is being implicated here? And maybe we can already relate this to agency, because that will become more relevant, but also sameness, difference. How is he navigating that terrain, and then also the issue of change and constancy. Anything that we can gather, put together here under this header? Martin Deger, I just saw you thinking. You had a typical thinking gesture.
I think Andrea is raising her hand.
But now Martin Deger disappeared. All right, I'm like in a classroom where I call on my students. So Andrea, I hear you had your hand raised.
Sure.
Go ahead.
So he says, obviously highlighted in red there, I grew up as a small town boy in North Carolina. To me, that's him trying to create a sameness with the audience. He's positioning himself with the audience and trying to make them feel, oh, I can understand his perspective, where he's coming from, what it must be like and feel like to be who he is. He came from nothing and I worked very hard. So he's showing that he had agency and worked really hard to get there, but also that he's the same as the audience and he's relatable and creating some sort of cushion for his explanation of what is to come.
Good, thank you. Thank you, Andrea. Right, I mean, yeah, growing up is not necessarily yet a kind of an agentive thing because, you know, you can't do much about it. You typically grow up. But then when it comes to working very hard, and then the next lines as well, I think they definitely mark himself, not only syntactically in subject position, but also as a semantic agent here. Yeah, I work very hard. And if you work hard, you typically get a good grade, or you know, you change the world in one or another way, you know, unless your work is meaningless, etc. But we'll get to that point. Yeah. Anyone else?
I think Martin has his hand.
Okay, Martin. Maybe Cynthia has something. Okay, cool.
Yes, since you called me out, I was indeed thinking, so you identified that correctly. No, I was just thinking, I mean, this is an attempt here to make himself the same with the audience with respect to the dreams that you have, what you want to achieve in your life. This is the typical kind of American hero story, right? He came out of nothing, but he had success. So this is what he's preparing here. I'm dreaming the same dream everyone else is dreaming. Starting this kind of David Copperfield-ish. I grew up, you know, and then I raised to something famous. Good.
Thank you. Yeah, yeah. And, you know, it's I know Cynthia, you know, I mean, this sounds so specific. He was he came from a small town in North Carolina. You know, I bet there's nobody in the audience right now who is coming from a small town in North Carolina. But as you mentioned, the Copperfield, Tom Sawyer, etc., we all know what that means. And wherever we grew up, even if it was in Guangzhou, China, which is a big city, a huge city, we can identify with this type of small town boy, if not through the literature, through that genre, but also this is me. Yeah, this is us. We would like to be. So there's an alignment and affiliation with an audience that is, I think, now global, worldwide, not only American, but definitely incorporating parts of Europe and I think even of Asia as well. Yeah, we identify with that type of character. And then that type of character is agentively, so it looks like, moving themselves out of this small town where everybody knows each other, and there's not much to do. It's kind of a boring place, but moving themselves out into a worldly position to change world, like in 11 and then in particular in 12. Cynthia, sorry, did I preempt anything there?
No, just lots of thoughts. This conversation and the training is rich for me. My initial reaction to your interpretive analysis was like, oh yeah, I can buy that interpretation. It seems, you know, plausible on the one hand, but before you provided your sense of this as an analyst, I think what came to me was my own positionality as a woman. Like I couldn't really get past or understand, why is he talking about this? He cheated on his wife, he's being asked about it, and how he could just move into this. And would I do that as a woman? And so that was my thought, but then it raised the question, which you may get to later if you have time, of, in this work, how do you write up or think about your own positionality, you know, as an analyst? Because I hope that made sense.
Yeah, no, absolutely, absolutely. Right. I mean, what Cynthia is alluding to here is the kinds of interpretive frameworks that we bring to these lines. And when I said, look, you know, that is so much me, there is something exactly that relates to the boy literature in particular. You know, I bet there's also a good chunk of white girl literature that alludes to similar values. But that, I think, if we can postpone this a little bit, and we have to come back to that, where does that take us with our cultural, gender, ethnic backgrounds that we bring to the interpretation of positions? Yeah, good. But I think we would agree that the we could agree definitely that the uptake here of a agentive position, working hard and dreaming to be able to do something hopeful and helpful to other people in their lives, moves the character into a agentive position, into a highly agentive position. Yeah, to dream, to anticipate a future, and going to college and becoming here a lawyer, which in the United States is not the protagonist of the world changer necessarily, but it's a route for something that is highly agentive. Yeah, to anticipate, follow the steps over years, and then become somebody who is having an impact, yeah, with the direction of fit from person to world. So let's see again. Okay, there was another person with a raise.
Yes, can I talk?
Yeah, I can see you, but...
I apologize to you. I'm in bed, so it's a little embarrassing to turn on my camera. I'm just thinking that what he's trying to do is... I'm wondering if he has this discourse planned, if he has planned his response, or if it is a spontaneous response. And if it is a spontaneous response, I'm wondering to what degree it's unconscious. To me, what he's trying to do is simply bringing out his humanness, the fact that he is an ordinary man who, despite being a small town boy, was successful. And in a sense, I think unconsciously, he's trying to justify his actions, saving face, so to speak.
Right. I mean, I think I would agree. The questions that you raised earlier, you know, to what degree is this planned discourse or spontaneous? I think those are not a relevant question. We distinguish this typically when it comes to writing, to written statements or written stories, because that's where more reflection seems to be at place and more correction, self-correction. Whether it is conscious or unconscious, that is a question I would try not to follow through with, because it's kind of a hole that we never really can get out of. What of these kinds of stories and assumptions that we bring to that are so deep that we can put them into the category of we are not really aware of that, or not much aware. But anyway, I think those are the kinds of assumptions, kinds of questions that we definitely can follow through. Yeah, how much of this is part of his genre of being a politician that he has exercised, practiced his life, yeah? Or what of it is something that comes out of the situation here right now, that is a response to this particular question. I think that's a field that we also can keep in mind. Good, so let me just continue with a little bit here of what he says next. Yeah, through a lot of work and success, I got some acclaim as a lawyer. And here I'm already having made my comment that this is a passive construction. Yeah, I got. So this is where he positions himself at the recipient then. Yeah, and here he is becoming the object in the sentence. People were telling me, yeah, he took himself out of the subject position, the syntactic position of where he was the agent when he worked hard and tried to change the world. And then these people put him into the he, the pronouns. I mentioned that pronouns are a gold mine. He distances himself from where he was before as an agent. Yeah, they give him all these attributes. And again, I think this is where the facial expression was leaning back and saying, you know, kind of, I don't know why they did this. And I really didn't want to be necessarily in that position. So we can try to bring this and hook this into a correspondence. And then they move into a direct quote, you are gonna go, no telling what you'll do. And this is, and then he turns back to himself. I was 30, 31 years old, went from a senator, young senator, to being considered for vice president, running for president, and this is a list, yeah, becoming a public figure. Okay, so he adds to this list all the kinds of achievements, but the achievements here, to summarize this briefly, are not necessarily achievements where he says, I achieved them through hard work, and that was because I'm a good person, I'm a good lawyer, I'm a good whatever, I'm a hard worker. No, he gives the credit for these achievements to others. Yep. So from there, then he moves in line 27, and that's what I want to briefly focus on that he construes this as being fed. And being fed is not only a passive construction, but it is, I think, the most passive, the undergoer perspective, almost force-fed, yeah, of these values, yeah, self-focus, egotism, narcissism. And then the pronoun changes to that leads you, yeah, not only that led him as a past construction to believe that he could do whatever he wanted, that he was invincible, and that there would be no consequences. So there is a way of phrasing this as something that would happen to anyone who is in that particular situation, brought into the limelight of politician focus, where the process is resulting or culminating in something that these people are fed with, yeah, so that they and you would be in the same situation. Now, this is a generalized view that, yeah, leads one to believe that one can do whatever one wants to. One is looking, at least seemingly, invincible. Yeah, that there are no consequences to whatever you do. And then does that make sense? I mean, we can stop here and talk about that, my line of interpretation here, this far. But from there, then he moves into nothing. And that's where this smile pops up. Nothing could be further from the truth. Yeah, and at first, when you hear this, you say, what is he talking about? What could not be further from the truth? Yeah. So he continues, and I'll go back to the slide in a second. Okay. Nothing could be further from the truth. So what is this smile doing here? And, you know, trying to come up with a alternative to that he is masking shame and guilt, and that there's a laughter in his performance of his answer to the question, how could you have done this? There's an answer within which this, as an explanation, hopefully his story makes sense to an audience and will most likely, hopefully, regain the trust so that he is, at the next election cycle, voted up into office again.
I just want to quickly highlight a comment that Brenda made in the chat, which I think is also relevant to this portion. So I'll just read this out loud, give you a chance to respond.
Thank you.
So Brenda said, a defensive response to the accusatory question as the interviewer questions his integrity. So he jumps to clarify that his old self, authentic self, which throughout the narrative he's attempting to differentiate from the adopted identity, intentions have always been in the quote, right place, reinstating his goodness, which is being questioned here right in the beginning.
Thank you, Brandon, right? Brandon?
I
think that makes perfectly sense to the way he uses pronouns and moves himself from this agentive, yeah, being responsible for what he has been doing in his early childhood and leading himself up to running for political office. But then things get out of hand, so to speak, and his agency is taken away from him. And I think what you just mentioned, how that is foreshadowing already a way of removing himself from any kind of responsibility or from a certain good amount of responsibility, that makes total sense. Right? I think that's what we can assume. Yeah, this is an interpretive framework here. He is doing, and again, you know, from the question of Shunjai, I think mentioned that, is he doing this consciously? Has he practiced that? He didn't have too much time to practice this. And I think in that situation, also to make this and learn this is not the best way to do it. So there is a certain amount of practices that I think we can expect a politician or a celebrity actor acquainted with. But then there's also a certain amount of something that you have to decide on the spot of how do I answer this question and how do I present whatever I'm trying to present in the best light. We can also speculate, I would be open to that even, you know, did he think about this storyline of having been a good kid to where he is now? Because that is intuitively something that we might use in a situation like this, where we have done something that is objectionable and that we have been caught. And so now how do we justify this? Good. I mean, I think we've got to weave this into the larger line of how he creates and navigates the three identity dilemmas and creates a sense of self that I think here with his smile, he may be already signaling he is comfortable with. Yeah, because it is not true that you can believe and that you are invincible and that you can do whatever you want to and that there are no consequences. I think here in line 36, he is distancing himself strongly from the way he had characterized himself moving into a particular position. Yeah, so there is a position that he has taken, yeah, but he is being fed that position. And now he's saying, look, you know, I'm distancing myself, I'm disaligning myself from this way of making sense of who I really, and we get to that toward the end, really am. So if we move on from here, because here he starts to reopen the case by saying, okay, you know, that's there, but here's the important thing that I want to convey. The important thing is, how could I ever get to the place? And then there is this, and this of course is a gold mine as well, whenever people self-correct. Yeah, because they said something, and then if you self-correct yourself, you take something back that has been out in the realm of the public already, or at least for the interaction. So this is where the place, so to speak, this place is moved into that place. And you know the difference between this and that is, this is near, this is here, and that is there, that is farther away. So there is a distancing in terms of the placial placement here of where I belong. Yeah, how I could ever get to that place and allow myself to let that happen. And this is also a phrase that is quite common in apologies, where we hear people say, I don't know why I did that, or how could I allow myself to let that happen, where it is questionable who is the allower. Is that the young boy inside himself, or where is the existence of this person that allowed himself, or the instance that allowed himself to do something. Yeah, and who is the one who is allowed to do this? Now, this kind of phrase fits perfectly other approaches that work with the so-called voices, the voice approach, yeah, where there are two voices within a person, and one is typically the more positive, moral, justified person, and the other one is the one that wants to smoke a cigarette or something like this, in contrast. And so this is where these voices are pitted against one another. And the listening approach, we had a salon a couple of months ago where the listening approach was presenting their way of working with data. And I think that would be a goldmine here, this particular phrase, for that type of analysis. Okay, so he continues and sums up basically what he had started with. Can I explain to you what happened? Yeah, giving reasons for what happened, and in doing so, opening up, launching into a narrative or how the changes that took place so this could happen, or even less, so this would lead to himself allowing himself to this happening. Yeah, and the reasons here, and again, it's hatched by, he believes this. He is not certain about this. He believes that this has happened is due to a long process of change, yeah, where I became somebody different. And here he hatches it and says, at least on the outside. So what does that do, that the outside and then the inside distinction that is coming up at the very end? Yeah, I'm at the core in my inside in line 54. I'm exactly the same person. So he argues with regard to change and constancy that he is the same person. At the outside, however, and this is, I think, again, to hedge this, it looks like for him, and he suggests that to the audience, to him, his interviewer, but also in the same breath to the audience that is sitting and watching this, us as viewers, us as people who vote for politicians. At the outside, you know, it looks like he has changed, but the inside, he is the same. I think Andrea has her hand up.
Yeah. Hi. So, like, for me, I see him working hard to construct sameness and identity with this little boy who he was when he was growing up. But also now into the future, he is who he is, but he also has the identity of that little boy, but he also has the identity of this man who he was forced to become. So he's navigating these two identities, how he wants to portray it to the audience, and saying, I'm this little boy and this little boy has agency, but now I was forced into being this man who has all these horrible things done to them. And this little boy hasn't changed, and this man has, but I want you to see the little boy that I am trying to tell you hasn't changed.
Thank you. That sounds, yep, that sounds very intuitively supporting, you know, the way I think we are trying to make sense of him. Yep, Nancy?
Yeah, I just wanted to add in and return to something Cynthia said earlier. And when we think about the audience and its relation to master narrative, who watches Dateline? Who's going to be watching this interview is primarily females, you know, to hear the justification, how could you do this? And I think there's a very complex statement going on. I'm a good person. Anybody in my position might have done it. But then to put on top of it, but I'm better than any person. And so it's a very particular kind of alignment for a very particular audience, I think, vis-a-vis a master narrative. And I'm not quite sure how to get that in with your three levels, because I'm linking the two different parts.
Right. Yeah, thank you. I mean, it perfectly fits the at least the navigation of change, right? Sameness, the constancy and change. It also, I think, relates to the navigation of sameness and difference. Yeah, because he tries to argue, look, you know, it would happen to you in the same way it happened to me. Yeah, taking his agency out, and that politicians, or as we will hear, I hope we still have a couple of minutes at least to listen to Edison Chen. Yeah, the way he presents himself as a celebrity, also these things are just happening. Yeah, and it makes sense. Yeah, if you employ a particular background or number of background assumptions, and we've got to work toward that as well. And then the agency, right, the agency was taken away from himself. The agency coincides with a kind of moral goodness, with a moral standard. And when the agency was taken away, the kind of non-moral or less moral or immoral standards popped up, so to speak. Yeah. And that's where he also argues he was fed with the kinds of immoral standards. Zach?
Yes, I just want to read another comment from the chat from, I believe, Rissa or Risa. Says, just as an aside, throughout this exercise, I understand why high-profile apologies are such fertile ground for the lens of positioning theory. They are hyper-aware of the ways the public level three dominant discourses perceive them. Their careers are hinged upon this, after all. There is so much going on with agency, continuity slash change, sameness slash difference, even in this one clip.
I love that. Thank you. Yes, I totally agree. And one of these background assumptions also, I think, that is employed here, again, this is to make yourself similar to others, is the assumption that children, as young, the younger they are, the more innocent they are, which is not necessarily a shared belief in all communities. Now, if you go into the into more religious backgrounds. This is where children, I grew up in one of those, but not my family, where children are born pretty bad. And then only through early religious Bible reading, they become good and are socialized into a better self, you know, but they are born as sinners and then have to be removed out of this sinning stage into, yeah. So the assumption that children are born innocent and are innocent is a relatively new one. And I also think it is, correct me, Martin, if you think differently here, that this comes with a good amount of Eurocentric ways of viewing childhood, in particular over the last couple of hundred years. Yeah. So I think that's one of the master discourses running through this, but also the other one, I think the comment right now that Zach read, the issue of politicians as being responsive and responding to the kinds of assumptions that are circulating in the realm of viewers, I think are exactly something that is brought in, that is circulating now in a way of coming up with a story that makes you trustworthy, authentic, and then by doing so, electable again. Yeah, because that's the kind of ultimate issue that is. And again, you know, I don't think that this is all necessarily reflected, but I also think this is not anything that is at the level of unconscious motivations, but this is it's in the middle of a calculated way of practicing a sense of who we are in these kinds of discourses, typically not in public interviews, but I think these are the everyday discourses that we are using when we are with friends, when we are with our students, et cetera, et cetera. We have another hand up here, Andrea. We can't hear Andrea. Is there anybody else? Okay, so if there isn't anything else, then I think I would like to, at least we have not quite 20 minutes left, 15 minutes left, move on with the summary here of what I think may be at work that I also would to tap into, and this is the discourse of recovery. That he has been thinking about what happened, and there's a kind of a therapeutic way of talking about these things. Yeah, from innocence to being a sinner, there also seemed to be a religious undertone, which for North Carolina, especially for South Carolina, is a very important discursive background. These are assumptions that are built into the way politicians have to brand themselves. And it is done by the use of verbal means, particular lexical and syntactic choices, building thematic building blocks, and then also the segmentation, the prosody, the way intonation, the self-corrections, the pausing, the hesitation markers here. Yeah, I believe I became somebody. Those are not randomly thrown in. Yeah, those are not random kinds of devices or cues. Yeah, we don't see much of hand movement here in this. There's a little bit, but we see a lot of gaze from Edwards vis-a-vis the interviewer. At least that's what we can infer, where the camera is because he's not showing in the camera if it isn't behind interviewer. So these kinds of components, the expression of facial displays, I think those are all in concert as aspects that are woven into our bodily performances. Yeah, not performance, not as a way of theatric performance, but as a way of being and doing what we are doing when we talk, when we come up with these stories and how we deliver them. So this is not an addition. This is not another aspect of being authentic or coming across as authentic and navigating these territories, but rather our bodily ways of doing this is woven into our words, syntactic choices. Yeah, and this is where language gives us these choices of navigating these spaces differently. So I want to quickly turn to Edison Chen. Edison Chen is a big figure in Asia, in Hong Kong, and he got caught with something else. Namely, he had made the pictures of women that he was with, good friends of his or lovers. And then when his laptop was stolen, no, it wasn't stolen, it was in the shop, and parts of his software and the pictures were taken off and then distributed over the net. And so what happened here is that he disappeared from Hong Kong and spent a year in abroad, and basically in the States and Canada. And then he reappeared in 2010 and asked for an interview. And here's the interview, just so that we have a glance at least at this, because his way of navigating these kinds of spatial position territories is different, but it is also very similar. So let's have a listen to this one.
You were a highly visible presence in this part of the world until the scandal really blew up. What have you been doing with your days since it happened?
I've been doing a lot of things.
Okay, I'm recalling him for a second because this very beginning, I think, is also very telling. There is a laughter here, and there's also this breath intake, and then there's a head movement. And I was trying to give meaning to that or see it as meaningfully embedded as bodily reactions to what he's saying next and how he's saying what he's saying. And by the way, I mean, the bodily reactions are usually preempting the kind of verbal reactions to whatever is coming. So they are readable in terms of what is happening and verbalized next.
What have you been doing with your days since it happened?
I've been doing a lot of things. it took me a little while, but you know, with the constant support of everyone around me, you know, my family especially, and my girlfriend, and I kind of got through that shell again. I kind of got through this I'm nothing and I'm done and I might as well give up stage, and you know, started to see what I could do that was valuable in the area that I was in. And I was in America, I was in LA and New York mostly. And in I've always wanted to either direct or produce movies. So I, you know, decided to take some crash courses, follow some producers, and try to learn the game of production. Not only did I have time to do some of the things I enjoyed, some of the things that I dreaded at first, like doing my laundry or throwing out the garbage or going to the grocery store, actually became something that really grounded me and really gave me a different perspective of life, because I've been working in the entertainment industry since I was 19. I was very young. I didn't really have a great outlook on life, to be honest with you. I was just out of school. It was like a party. You know, every day was like a party. I kind of got accustomed to that life where everything was taken care of, where I thought I was a pretty good person, and then I went back and I kind of had to do all these things by myself, and I kind of reflected on the way I treated people and the way I saw things, and I got a lot more grounded, and I am thankful for that, you know? I mean, everything, I believe that everything happens for a reason.
All right, okay, so, yeah, let's just take a couple of seconds here, minutes, to work with how he answers. We don't have the time to see it again and read it, but there is at the very beginning the question, the typical question of these types of interviews. Yeah, you were a highly visible presence in this part of the world in Asia until the scandal really blew up. So what have you been doing with your days since it happened? Yeah, seemingly innocent question, but it's a question that is obviously assisting in something that we call small stories, that is a kind of a narrative practice of whitewashing, of the presenting a sense of self that is coming to grips with the kinds of potential underlying accusations that we heard much clearer in the previous one. Yeah, and that's where this exhaling is at the very beginning. I've been doing a lot of things, and then kind of a laughing. It's not a loud laughter, obviously. It took me a little while, but you know. And now what we typically look at is the kind of characters, because he is starting a story. Yeah, it's a very small story, but he's bringing up some characters, producing characters, everyone around him. So somebody who is near and close, his family and his girlfriend. So why and how are these characters made relevant? Why are they talked about? You know, why not the person who serves his coffee in the coffee store, or one of the producers he's working with? No, these, I think, are strategically designed to bring people from his inner circle into it, and in particular, to also show that he still is trustworthy, at least to those who know him well. And even, you know, although the issue of his wrongdoing had to do with women, that he has a girlfriend, somebody in the flaunting his heterosexuality, is trusting him. So this is, I think, a very good start in order to come across to a larger audience, to bring them into this inner circle of people who used to trust him and his brand and his products and bought them. And here he is starting small. And I kind of got through this shell, as something that protected him, and kind of got through this. I'm nothing, I'm done, and I might as well give up stage. Yeah, like I was down, I was inagentive, I couldn't do anything. Yeah, agency is coming here, in here. And then he claims some agency. I've started to see what I could do. And if you start to see what you can do, you may also do it. So this is the beginning or the pre-stage of claiming agency. Yeah, what was valuable in the area I was in. So he collected his background. So this is a kind of a continuity. Yeah. And then he goes to America. He was in LA and New York. And I always wanted to be there, decided So this is taking some action, some crash courses, and already also navigating change. Yeah, following some producers. And then I tried to learn the game of production. Not only did I have time to do some of these things, I enjoyed. Yeah. So there was a different life stage, so to speak, from where he just moved himself out of into enjoying life again, so to speak. Not only did I have time to do things that I enjoyed, some of these things that I dreaded at first, like doing my laundry or throwing out garbage and going going to the grocery store. So this is also, I think, where he very nicely starts to relate to people like me. You know, I'm not doing my laundry, but I sometimes take the garbage out. And sometimes I love actually going to grocery stores. But this is something that he claims now, where he, I think, aligns himself, affiliates with the rest of the population who exactly have to do these kinds of things. And again, he is navigating change here. I actually became something that really grounded me. A change in not just perspective, but also in his way of being in the world. And it gave him a different perspective of life, because I've been working in the entertainment industry since I was 19, was very young. And here comes the discourse, or the master discourse, of what do you do when you're young, when you're a teenager? You don't have an outlook on life. I'm already transforming this into the how it aligns with people like us. Yeah, and he also claims here that he is honest with us. We do that a lot in those situations. Yeah, I was out of school. This was like a party, you know. Everything was like a party. I kind of got accustomed to that life. Everything was taken care of. In terms of agency, there was no agency. I didn't have to take any agency. But more so, there's also an implied kind of accusation. Yeah, things were coming to me. And I think this is the discourse then also of celebrity. Yeah, in that situation, or richness or privilegedness. I didn't have to do anything about this. And underneath, however, I thought that I was a pretty good person. But then I went back and looked at myself. So this is where reflection is coming in. I kind of had to do all these things by myself and reflected on the way I treated people, the way I saw things. I got a lot more grounded, and I'm thankful for that. And then the summary statement, I mean, everything, I believe that everything happens for a reason. So this is, in a sum, I was more repeating it than doing some analysis, bringing a little bit of the analysis in to how agency is navigated, from having no agency to becoming more agentive, but then looking back at what I learned in America, of all places, to become more agentive, taking my garbage out and reclaiming the kind of agency that aligns myself with sameness here to everybody else in this world. Because before, as a celebrity, I was in a separate space, similar to John Edwards, because when he became a celebrity due to other people who moved him into this space, that's where he, Edison Chen now, finds who he really is, gets grounded. Being grounded is a claim toward that's my real self. And then that's when I found this. I'm looking back and it happened for a reason. So change, agency, sameness, we have them again woven into the answer, this particular answer, to something like an innocent question, that said, so what have you been doing with your time, with your days, right? Whether this is all practiced beforehand, I doubt it. But nevertheless, it comes across as spontaneous. but nevertheless also with a lot of practice that an actor, somebody who is relatively young, but still has practiced a million times to take on the persona of somebody that we have to represent in a movie. So there's something here, I think, to work with in more detail. I've done this and we can do this, but I also wanted to have a couple more minutes. It's 4:59. A couple more minutes to potentially have some reactions and also see how we can work with this framework in different parts with different data that you may have at this point that my data does not directly speak to, but is a way of possibly find some ways to transfer the analysis into other data sets. I think we can get out of the PowerPoint. Stop sharing. Here we go. Irene.
Okay, Michael, I have a question. Do you have any suggestions for further reading, both theoretical and methodological?
Thank you, Cynthia. The last slide gives some readings more to the theoretical parts. Yes, I mean, there are some more. I may add another slide and put this onto wherever we will publish this. I think we are thinking of putting this, making this available to YouTube. But thank you. Yes. Yes, I do. Irene, you have your hands up.
Thank you. Relating to what Cynthia and Nancy mentioned earlier, I was wondering, what do you think, like, to what extent do we really have to look at for what audience this kind of positioning is meant to be? Like, I was wondering, what's the relational aspect in this, right? Because, like, so far I understood that we, like, leave this aside to some extent, but I found that interesting to think about, like, what's the audience in terms of, in this specific case, race and gender and so on.
Yeah, right. I mean, okay, there are three aspects here. I think one is, if we have access to what Nancy argued, that ABC is typically much more viewed by a particular kind of viewership, I think then we can work with this. We have to be a little careful because we don't want to build the interpretation on geared toward a particular audience. But if we can take this out of the way the master discourses, background assumptions are brought into the discourse, I think we have a good foot to stand on. So we don't want to assume previous to the delivery, who the audience is that is being targeted. On the other hand, you know, we don't want to simply assume that the audience is universal, you know, that this applies to anyone. But I think analytically, we want to try to work with as much of the data to come to assumptions about who is potentially being targeted. Who is the audience, in particular, when it comes to these larger presentations online or being broadcasted wildly? And most often our data don't come from those kinds of data sources. But then the other thing that Cynthia brought up earlier, to go back there, I think is, how is slightly different, because it's, she mentioned, how is what I'm focusing on when I work with these data along the lines I suggested, how much of this is framed already or constrained by the interpretive schema, by the interpretive framework that I bring as white male, relatively aged. Other aspects of my being in the world, how much of that do I bring into the kinds of interpretation I just did here with you guys? So I think that is an important question, though it is also one that we ultimately should not be too much afraid of, because if we argue too long about our own positionality and try to analyze our own positionality, I think we are not getting closer to the data. So we are at risk of bringing assumptions to the data. But the good part of it is, I think, that we, or the beneficial part, is that we can also reflect on the kinds of assumptions that we bring to analyzing our data. In particular, if we work with teams, or like I just tried to show, present our data and work with others who say, well, wait a minute, you know, there's something here that you may not have been aware of. And I think in those situations, that will be enriching the interpretation of data. So what I'm trying to argue here is that the interpretation is never one that once and for all says this is what's going on. They are always these interpretations are always tentative, yeah, and they are open to be modified. But nevertheless, I still want to argue that this is a relatively good way of getting started with these interpretations. Yeah, bridging them and relating them to discourses that are prevalent, that most likely people bring into their stories when trying to make sense, in particular when trying to make sense of situations that are somewhat out of the ordinary. But even in ordinary stories, these kinds of interpretations that people bring, the background stuff that people bring into their stories, are analyzable. They are there. Yeah, careful with the kinds of interpretations that we bring to these stories, but nevertheless, I think they are there and they are open to be discussed among interpreters.
Thank you.
I have a question. Am I audible?
Yes, we can hear you. Thank you.
Well, I want to understand that when you're particularly looking at here, there are pre-recorded stories that people are narrating to another set of audience and to another interviewer. But in cases where we have to use this theory and this this kind of a narrative analysis, specifically in situations where there are real-time conversations happening, and where, say, in a qualitative study where you try to understand the lived experiences of certain people with certain experiences or a certain life events that have been very drastically shaping their personality or their identities. And there is an intersubjectivity that has been undertaken between the interviewer and the participant. So the narrative is being constructed vis-a-vis the two people who are very intimately having conversations, very detailed conversations amongst each other. So in that kind of a scenario, how would this analysis play out? And then how would we determine our own positionality while we are not just listening to it, but also interpreting it side by side as interviewers? And then consequently also asking certain kind of questions in response to their narratives and how that's also shaping the story. So I wanted to, I don't know if I've been coherent enough.
No, thank you. You know, I mean, this is open not a can of worms, but a can of, I think, important considerations. Yeah, what you had in the examples that I picked here is where the interviewer is not necessarily hostile, but it's also not kind of aligning totally with the interviewee. And what you're alluding to is that there are these totally different interviews, totally different, but they are different, where the interviewer is aligning with the interviewee. And I think this is particularly interesting when it comes to the type of action research where the researcher is engaged and involved in the kind of general orientation that the interviewee is putting forth. So where the two of them are much more in cahoots, so to speak, to bring certain agenda out into the open, with a very different motivation than the interviewers had in those two examples, where the interviewers had the kind of motivation to get themselves, the interviewers, and make them relevant and increase their the viewership and their ratings. While in a scenario that I just put together, and I think you alluded to that a little bit, apart also from a therapeutic interview, which is very different when it comes to the alignment and the disalignment of interviewer and interviewee. But nevertheless, I would want to argue that the type of positioning and positioning analysis of how the way characters are constructed in order to navigate these three spaces still may remain very fruitful and productive for figuring out what is going on between narrator and here interviewer. The typical way of doing it in traditional interview analysis is that the interview is the object of the analysis. As something that where the interviewee is responding and disclosing something that is assumed as part of the internal or personality or whatever that is sitting deep inside. And this is where the interview then is supposed to be the means to pull this out of the person. Yeah, and if that is the case, I think this has to be analyzed as well as part of preconditions that are at work in this business of doing interviews. Yeah, and I think you're opening it up to a lot broader and also, I think, very interesting components of what is being analyzed when we deal with the analysis of stories. And in particular, typically, fortunately, unfortunately, in psychology, in interviews. But interviews, I think, that has become more and more over the last 10 years, are not anymore considered to be these innocent means into participants' internal makeup or their sense making or who they really are as authentic beings. Rather, as that's what I was trying to show, that authenticity also is something that is being produced, that is being performed in a way. Yeah, and it comes across because Edison Chen seemingly comes across as highly believable to men and women, at least in Asia. So this is what I hear from my students when I taught in China. John Edwards is not believable at all. I mean, my students in America, I don't know how other students in Asia would react to John Edwards. But he is interpreted as a slime face, and but there are also, I think, aspects, cueings that are read in a particular way, and I wonder why. Yeah, for instance, I can't stop on this, but John Edwards in this interview situation is forced to have eye contact with the interviewer. And I think in a situation where you have to show regret, you have to look down, you have to avoid eye gaze. And there's something here that the interview situation requires, yeah, to have gaze, typically, because that's the unmarked case. You look at the other person like I do now, or try to. While in a confessional, so you look away, you do not have eye gaze, at least in the kinds of confessions we are part of in Europe and the United States. So there is something within these bodily cueings of how authentic am I, or how authentic am I coming across, that is being read and interpreted, again, against these kinds of background assumptions that we have as cultural background assumptions. And again, this is, I think, where we have to be very careful with what we say and what we write about these kinds of things. But this is where we are. And that makes it, I think, really interesting rather than questionable or problematic.
Thank you.
Well, I think we are a little bit over time. It's 5:15 here in Western Europe, which is Western Europe, Central Europe. But if you have any, let me just say this one thing, because for the spring semester, the American spring semester, I'm planning to teach a qualitative course for graduate students and young scholars. And I would like to use now what we have at the conference to open this up to more international, not just audiences, participants. So where exactly the kinds of questions that just came up, what are the backgrounds against which we make interpretations will be discussed more deeply. And I think what I need in particular are students and scholars from different parts of the world in order to help us, me here in this particular situation, out of the kinds of background assumptions that we kind of nilly-willy take for granted and become more critical of them. So I would like to invite anyone who is interested in a course that will be jointly taught then online, most likely with Zoom, once a week meeting. And we have to find a time in the day then, of course, which is already a big problem for the conference, but we are navigating, we are moving into new territories here. So anyone who is interested, please contact me and I will, I promise I will respond. Having said that, I think this is a good way to conclude, and I appreciate that you stayed with me this long. And I hope I'll see you again in the next couple of days, because Zachary and I, we will be kind of day and night assisting in getting the conference off the ground and to a hopefully productive ending. Thank you, everyone, and stay in touch and be good and stay safe these days as well.